an inmate on death row, nominated for a Nobel Peace Prize, and a gang leader. How did Stanley Tookie Williams end up in the barrer of all these titles? Tookie was born on December 29, 1953, in New Orleans, Louisiana. His father abandoned the family when Williams was just a year old, and in 1959, Williams moved with his mother, Louisiana Williams, to Los Angeles, California, and settled in the city's South Central region. As Williams' mother worked several jobs to support them, Williams was a latchkey kid and often engaged in mischief on the streets. He recalled that, as a child, he would hang out in abandoned houses and vacant lots around his neighborhood in South Central, where he would watch adults get drunk, abuse drugs, gamble, and engage in dog fights. Williams stated that after the adults finished the dog fighting, they would make the children fight each other, including himself. Williams began to participate in these street fights regularly as a child, where adults would bet on him and give him part of the proceeds for winning his fights. Williams was often the target of older bullies and street thugs in his neighborhood and, by the age of 12, began carrying a switchblade in order to protect himself. By the time Williams was a teenager, he had gained a reputation in South Central's West Side as a vicious street fighter. Williams was expelled from George Washington Preparatory High School and was blackballed by several other high schools in the South Central area for fighting, and eventually began doing stints in Central Juvenile Hall. In the late 1960s, juvenile crime increased in South Central as older gangs disbanded to join the Black Power movement, most notably as part of the Black Panther Party. Initially to protect black people from police brutality and corruption in the Los Angeles Police Department, increasingly violent youth gangs formed in their place, which Williams initially despised as predatory. But because of his viciousness and willingness to fight older youths, Williams earned the respect of many gangsters on the West Side. These gangs were mostly small-time neighborhood cliques that operated independently from each other, and leadership was not chosen but determined naturally. At age 15, Williams was invited into a small West Side clique after he befriended a local teenager, Donald. Williams soon earned the clique's respect after beating up one of their members for insulting his mother, and Williams became the unofficial leader of this clique as his violent reputation began to spread across South Central. When William was 16, he stole a car and ended up in jail. During his time in jail, he was introduced to other gang members. After his release from jail, he met up with Raymond Lee Washington. The two discussed and decided to form the gang, called the Crips. The Crips are a gang based in the coastal regions of Southern California. It was founded in Los Angeles, California, in 1969, mainly by Raymond Washington and Stanley Williams. Once a single alliance between two autonomous gangs, it is now a loosely connected network of individual sets, often engaged in open warfare with one another. Its members traditionally wear blue clothing, a practice that has waned somewhat due to police crackdowns targeting gang members. Historically, members have been primarily of African American heritage. The Crips are one of the largest and most violent associations of street gangs in the United States, with an estimated 30,000 to 35,000 members in 2008, they have been involved in murders, robberies, and drug dealing, among other crimes. Soon after the foundation of the Crips, Other leaders were either murdered or incarcerated, and Williams was regarded as the de facto leader. In 1974, Raymond Washington was arrested for second-degree robbery and served 5 years in prison in Tracy, and soon after was murdered. On February 23, 1973, Curtis Buddha Morrow was shot to death in South Central following a petty argument. Matt Thomas was murdered under mysterious circumstances in the mid-1970s. Williams began to live an ironic double life, where he worked in a legal job as an anti-gang youth counselor in Compton, while also serving as the overboss for one of the largest gangs in Los Angeles. Williams would work as a counselor and study sociology at Compton College during working hours, then spend his free time participating in numerous violent attacks against the Bloods. In 1976, Williams was wounded in a drive-by shooting while sitting on the porch of his house in Compton. The shooting was committed by members of the Bloods, who shot at Williams from their car as he was letting his dog out for a walk in the evening. Attempting to avoid getting hit, Williams dove to the ground from the porch, but was shot in both of his legs. Williams was told by doctors that he would never walk again, but after a nearly year-long process of physical rehabilitation and an intense workout regimen, he ultimately regained his ability to walk. After the shooting, Williams redeveloped a substance abuse problem. When he began smoking PCP, Williams had begun dabbling in street drugs around the age of 12. And as a preteen befriended a neighborhood pimp who, in return for performing errands for him, would reward Williams with money and drugs, particularly Quaalude, barbiturates or marijuana. Williams' personal life began to unravel. His maternal grandmother, with whom he was very close, died in 1976. He lost his counseling job in 1977, after being implicated in a robbery that was committed by two youths from a group home that Williams supervised. He was denied an opportunity to compete in an amateur bodybuilding contest, after it was discovered that he was a gang leader. Williams would later appear on the 1970s variety show The Gong Show performing a pose-down routine. Eventually, his gangster lifestyle was beginning to take a mental toll on him, which included a brief stay in the psychiatric ward of a hospital after Williams experienced a bad trip. While high on PCP, with each of these setbacks, Williams increasingly found himself using PCP and supported his drug habit by intimidating and robbing drug dealers in South Central. On Tuesday evening, February 28, 1979, Williams introduced a man called Daryl to friends of his, Alfred Blackie Coward, and to Bernard Witte Trudeau, and a short time after the initial meeting, Daryl, driving a brown station wagon and accompanied by Williams and Coward, drove to the home of James Garrett. Williams frequently stayed and kept some possessions at Garrett's home, including a 12-gauge shotgun, and after about 10 minutes inside, Williams returned with the shotgun. Williams, Daryl, and Coward then went to the home of Tony Sims in Pomona, where they discussed possible locations to obtain money through robbery. Afterwards, they went to another residence where Williams left the others and returned with a .22 caliber pistol and placed it in the station wagon. Daryl and Williams entered the station wagon, Coward and Sims entered another vehicle, and then embarked on the freeway. Both vehicles exited the freeway at California State Route 72. The first incident occurred at a nearby Stop and Go supermarket, where Daryl and Sims, at the request of Williams, entered the store with the apparent intention of robbing it. Daryl was carrying the .22 pistol that Williams had deposited in the station wagon earlier, and also had a rifle in the trunk of the car, along with two semi-automatic handguns. The clerk at the stop-and-go market, Johnny Garcia, had just finished mopping the floor when he observed a station wagon and the four men at the door to the market. Two of the men entered the market, and one of the men went down an aisle, while the other approached Garcia asking for a cigarette. Garcia gave the man a cigarette and lit it for him. After approximately 3 to 4 minutes, the men left the market without carrying out the planned robbery. Coward and Sims followed Williams and Daryl to the 7-Eleven market located at 10437 Whittier Boulevard in Whittier, where the second incident occurred. The store clerk, 26-year-old Albert Lewis Owens, was sweeping the store's parking lot at 7:42 p.m. when Daryl and Sims entered the 7-Eleven. Owens put the broom and dustpan he was using on the hood of his car and entered the store to serve them, and was followed in by Williams and Coward. As Daryl and Sims walked to the counter area to take money from the cash register, Williams walked behind Owens, pulled the shotgun from under his jacket, and told Owens to shut up and keep walking. While pointing the shotgun at Owens' back, Williams directed him to a back storage room and ordered him to lie down. Coward said that he next heard the sound of a round being chambered into the shotgun, then heard a shot and glass breaking, followed by two more shots. Williams had shot at a security monitor and then killed Owens, shooting him twice in the back at point-blank range as he lay prone on the storage room floor. The third incident occurred at the Brookhaven Motel, located at 10411 South Vermont Avenue in South Central Los Angeles, which was run by 76-year-old Yen Yi Yang and his wife, 63-year-old Tsai Shi Si Yang, their daughter, 43-year-old Yu Chin Yang Lin, and their son, Robert. The Yangs were immigrants from Taiwan, and Yu Chin had recently joined them in the United States to run the hotel. At approximately 5 a.m. on March 11, 1979, Williams entered the Brookhaven Motel lobby, and then broke down the door that led to the private office. Inside the office, Williams shot and killed Yen Yi, Tsai Shi, and Yu Chin, after which he emptied the cash register and fled the scene. Robert, asleep with his wife in their bedroom at the motel, was awakened by the sound of somebody breaking down the door to the motel's office. Shortly thereafter, he heard a female scream, followed by gunshots. Robert entered the motel office and found that his mother, his sister, and his father had all been shot, and the cash register was empty. Stanley Williams was convicted in 1981 of all four murders with aggravating circumstances on each count of felony murder as well as multiple murder in the case of the Brookhaven event. The jury also convicted him of robbery in both cases, and found that he personally used a firearm in the commission of the crimes. The jury returned a verdict of guilty, and the judge sentenced him to death. He was convicted by a jury that had no African Americans, one Latino, one Filipino American, and 10 white Americans. Williams became inmate at San Quentin State Prison in Northern California and spent 6 years in solitary confinement in the late 1980s for multiple assaults on guards and fellow inmates. In October 1988, Williams was stabbed in the neck and seriously injured by Tequan Cox in San Quentin State Prison. During his time in prison, Williams wrote numerous books. Most of them were deterrents for young people not to join gangs. He also was calling schools while he was on death row, talking to students and advising them not to be gang members. Tookie Williams appealed his conviction in the state courts and filed a petition in the federal courts for habeas corpus relief. The state courts affirmed the conviction, and the lower federal court denied the habeas corpus petition. In 2001, the United States Court of Appeals for the Ninth Circuit heard Williams' appeal from the lower federal court, and the appellate court denied Williams' appeal in 2002, but noted that the federal courts were not his only forum for relief, and that he could request clemency from the governor of California. In late 2005, a campaign began to urge Governor Arnold Schwarzenegger to grant clemency for Williams in consideration of his work as an anti-gang activist, with thousands of people signing online petitions calling for Schwarzenegger to commute the death sentence. In early November 2005, Williams' attorneys filed his formal petition for executive clemency, as well as a motion to obtain new evidence. California opposed the clemency petition through the office of the Los Angeles County District Attorney, who, along with the Los Angeles Police Department and other law enforcement groups, disputed that Williams had in fact reformed. Williams refused to inform officials on other gang members or the tactics and communication methods that the gangs used. He did not want to be a snitch. The clemency petition emphasized the theme of Williams' redemption and rehabilitation, rather than his claim of actual innocence. On December 12, 2005, Governor Schwarzenegger denied clemency for Williams. On December 13, 2005, 16 days away from his 52nd birthday, after exhausting all forms of appeal, Williams was executed by lethal injection at San Quentin State Prison. He was the 12th person to be executed by the state of California following the 1976 U.S. Supreme Court decision of Gregg v. Georgia. Williams provided no last words to the prison warden, but in an interview on radio, hours before the execution, where he stated, "My lack of fear of this barbaric methodology of death, I rely upon my faith. It has nothing to do with machismo, with manhood, or with some pseudo-former gang street code. This is pure faith, and predicated on my redemption. So, therefore, I just stand strong and continue to tell you, your audience, and the world that I am innocent and, yes, I have been a wretched person, but I have redeemed myself. And I say to you and all those who can listen and will listen that redemption is tailor-made for the wretched, and that's what I used to be. That's what I would like the world to remember me. That's how I would like my legacy to be remembered, as a redemptive transition, something that I believe is not exclusive just for the so-called sanctimonious, the elitists. And it doesn't is not predicated on color or race or social stratum or one's religious background. It's accessible for everybody. That's the beauty about it. And whether others choose to believe that I have redeemed myself or not, I worry not, because I know and God knows, and you can believe that all of the youths that I continue to help, they know, too. So with that, I am grateful, I say to you and everyone else, God bless. So take care." Williams showed no resistance as he was led into the execution chamber. After Williams was strapped to the gurney, he struggled against the straps holding him down to look up at the press gallery behind him and to exchange glances with his supporters. They had some trouble with the second IV, which was in the left arm. Williams, at one point, grimaced or looked almost out of frustration. He had his glasses on the whole time. He kept them on, and he kept looking. With a look of frustration on his face, Williams angrily asked the technicians, "You guys doing that right?" A female guard whispered to him. And a second guard patted Williams' shoulder as if to comfort him. Williams shed one silent tear, but otherwise showed no emotion as he was executed. Williams was pronounced dead at 12:35 a.m. Thank you for watching Death Row.